Aronsohn. I want to thank Giselle and Film New Zealand, and especially Fleur CYBILL for making it possible for me to be down here. I've never been to New Zealand before. It was one of the few things on my bucket list. We've got an absolutely gorgeous country. Let's keep it a secret. When I do these sort of things, I usually start off by reading a little essay I wrote many years ago, which sort of encapsulates how I feel about the business. I hate writing. I don't mean I dislike writing or that I don't enjoy writing. I mean that I hate writing with the fiery, white-hot loathing usually reserved for war criminals, child molesters, and TV agents. Let me see if I can personify it further. If writing were an actual person in a room with, say, Joseph Mengele, and I were armed with a sharp knife, I'd ask Mengele to please step aside while I lunged at writing's carotid artery. The only process I can think of that I've enjoyed less than writing involved a proctologist, a rubber glove, and the search for polyps in my lower intestine. But at least during that experience, I didn't have to worry about coming up with an act break. Plus, they gave me drugs. Really good drugs. But I digress. So, I can see the question forming on your lips. If you hate writing so much, why do you do it? That's a very complex question, which fortunately has a very simple answer. Money. See, here's the thing. I have no actual job skills. I can't program a computer, I can't fix a car, I can't build a house. The sad truth of my life is that I am completely incapable of performing any practical function whatsoever. In a post-apocalyptic society, my profession would be organ donor. So simply put, sitcom writing turned out to be the one thing I could do that people would pay me to do, which did not involve anal sex. Which is not to say that if you go into the TV business in the United States, you won't get fucked in the ass. There's very little actual bleeding and tissue damage. So, why do I hate it so much? Well, for starters, it's like having a term paper due every day of my life. And each time I sit down to begin a script, the realization comes crashing down on me that no matter how long I sit staring at the computer screen, no matter how much I curse, no matter how much I sweat, there are no jokes left. It's a fact. The world started with a finite number of jokes, and sometimes shortly after I finished my last script, the supply ran out. The jokes are all gone. Just like the passenger pigeon, the dodo bird, and I am told the internet mono party. Not only are there no jokes left, there are no more stories either. The approximately 3 bazillion sitcom episodes that have already been written have sucked up every possible storyline in the known universe. And yet, I still have to come up with something. And so I hack desperately away at the keyboard, trying futilely to bring some sort of twist on an old setup, find some way of finessing a familiar premise, all with the certain knowledge that even if I should actually succeed in finishing the script, once someone reads it and sees how lame and unfunny it is, a large man will be sent to my house to personally kick me out of show business. And I'll end up chugging cough syrup in an alley somewhere, fighting other former sitcom writers for the right to eat out of the better dumpsters. But you didn't come here to listen to my neurotic whining. Well, maybe a few of you did, and I hope you feel you've got your money's worth, you parasitic emotional vampires. But the rest of you came to learn something. So in the spirit of education, I'd like to close with a few words about my creative process. I have no creative process. Here's how I write. I procrastinate to the point of pathology, then when a deadline is so close that I have absolutely no choice but to write, I do so, driven by existential panic and a little voice telling me I am simply not good enough to accomplish whatever it is I'm attempting. That voice belongs to my ex-wife. I told you all the jokes were used. So that's that. So today, I was asked to just kind of go through the length and breadth of my career in sitcoms. I've worked on a lot of them. Sometimes, some of them you've heard of, some of them you haven't, and sucked my soul a little bit in one way or another. And so we'll just go through it. I started in Los Angeles in 1977. I'd gone to college in Colorado and met a girl in college and moved to Lincoln, Nebraska with her. Now, those of you who don't know United States geography, Lincoln, Nebraska is like in the very middle of the United States, and there is nothing there, okay, except this girl. And so I lived in Lincoln, Nebraska for a couple of years, and then she dumped me, and I'm in Lincoln, Nebraska with no fucking girlfriend. I decided to come to LA and pursue what was my childhood dream of being a class clown for money, and started doing stand-up comedy at the Comedy Store. Now, in those days, in 1977, there were a lot of comics at the Comedy Store who were unknown to everybody except the other people in the Comedy Store. Among them were Jay Leno, Robin Williams, David Letterman. It was very obvious to me very quickly that I was not going to be able to feed myself at stand-up comedy. The question was, what was I going to do? Well, like everybody else who comes to Hollywood, I came with a list of people that my family knew that had some sort of connection to show business. And one of these was a guy whose brother did my father's car insurance in New York. His name was Ben Jolson. And he and his writing partner were old-time TV writers. They'd been doing it, you know, for many, many years. They just got the job on a new show called Love Boat. And Ben came to see me perform, do my little stand-up shtick, and he said to me afterwards, you're pretty funny. Have you ever considered writing? And I said, no, I hate writing. As you may have noticed. And I gave him all the reasons that I hate writing. And then he told me what they were paying writers on the Love Boat. I said, you know, on the other hand. So I was very lucky. He sent me some scripts, he asked me to pitch him some stories, I wrote some spec pages for him. You know, it took months and months and months, but eventually I got an assignment on the Love Boat. And they liked that, they gave me another assignment, and another assignment, then they hired me on staff, and very quickly I went from being a broke stand-up comic, living on a bag of potatoes, you know, for 69 cents, I would just bake up one every day. to sitting in a bungalow on the lot of 20th Century Fox with a glass ashtray turned upside down and a pile of cocaine on it. Now, excuse me. In the late 70s in Hollywood, everybody did cocaine. The son of the network president used to come around the soundstage dealing cocaine. This is my first credit on the Love Boat. It was a tearjerker. I didn't pitch it as a tearjerker, but they turned it into one. It was basically a woman searching for her, the woman who gave her up for adoption, and she ends up sleeping with the guy who she thinks is her brother. And I thought incest was hilarious. They turned it into more of a heart, you know, a heart-wrenching story about the reunion between this woman and her mother. But as I was saying, everybody did cocaine. I actually except Vicky. But I did sit on a glacier in Alaska, snorting cocaine with Julie, your cruise director. The thing about Vicky is I created that character. It was Aaron Spelling, who was on the show, was the executive producer, wanted to create a show for Quinn Cummings, who was the little girl who starred in The Goodbye Girl. So the word came down, write something about the captain and the little girl. And I got the assignment to write it, and I wrote this, you know, this heart-wrenching story. It was all they would let me write, or the tearjerkers, and cast Jill Whalen in it because all of a sudden the girl he wanted wasn't available. And it went really well, so we wrote another episode, which brought her back, and she was on the series for the whole rest of the term. A little known fact about Vicky is She was named after my dog. That's Vicky the dog, and that's Vicky and me in 1969. This is the Alaska cruise where I did snort cocaine on a glacier with Julia, cruise director. If you look, right down there in the lower right-hand corner, this is from TV Guide. That's me. My first appearance in a national publication. That is me and your cruise director, Julie McCoy, stoned out of our gourds on a cruise ship. So, there's kind of a 3 to 6 year hiatus when I actually quit my job just to party and do drugs for a few years. And when I came back, I did get a job on Charles in Charge. Charles in Charge. Did you get that down here?
Yeah.
I have my own lyrics to that. Charles Discharge on our sheets every night. Charles Discharge, it is milky and white. Then I see, I don't want Charles Discharge on me. Anyway. This was in first run syndication, when first run syndication was getting very big. So it wasn't on a network, it was produced by Universal, and they just kept churning them out and selling them directly into syndication, and it made a ton of money for them. It was a great experience, it was a lot of fun. That girl is Josie Eggert, Josie Davis. This girl is Nicole Eggert. Everybody was in love with Nicole. Nicole was the pretty one. Okay. Let's fast forward about 15 years. There's Josie, and there's Josie. Yeah, the plain one kind of blossomed, and we cast her in an episode of Two and a Half Men, where she played a very hot little Christmas chick, and I just think it's just God's way of balancing out the scales, because Nicole Eggert ended up gaining a bunch of weight after she was on Baywatch, and Josie, who nobody paid attention to, became this incredibly hot, talented comedian. Next, I did Who's the Boss? I did that as a freelancer. I did 3 episodes, and the one thing I can tell you is that Judith Light has the skinniest wrists I have ever seen in a comedian. I'm not kidding. I mean, they're like this big. Tony Danza, fun guy. I ran into him years later. I almost did a show with him a couple years ago, a buddy comedy with him and Henry Winkler, who was the Fonz on Happy Days, but Tony's manager got in the way. Everything's Relative is a show you never heard of. It ran for, I don't know, less than 10 episodes on CBS. The only notable thing about it is that it was cast with a pre-Seinfeld Jason Alexander. And Jason had just won a Tony for a Neil Simon play, I believe it was Broadway Bound, and he wore a toupee in those days, as you can see. And after having won a Tony in what was basically a fairly dramatic play, putting him in a sitcom was a little bit of an adjustment, because he tended to play everything for the drama of it, not the laughs. And that's not the reason, the main reason that the show was canceled, but it didn't help, and luckily he got over that by the time he was cast in Seinfeld. Then I did a show called The People Next Door. Again, something you've never heard of, but it had a very interesting premise. Jeffrey Jones played a cartoonist, and the deal with this cartoonist was the things that he drew actually came to life. I used this opportunity for our Halloween episode to actually step in front of the camera, and that's me anticipating The Walking Dead by about 20 years as me as a zombie. Very proud of that. Then I did a show called Scorch, another show that you haven't heard of. Premise of this show was there was a ventriloquist and a puppet that were fairly big, you know, in clubs and stuff. And Alf was very big. You got Alf down here, the alien puppet. So CBS, that was on NBC, CBS decided they wanted their own puppet show. So they made a deal with Alf, the dragon puppet. And the premise of the show was this dragon puppet played a real dragon that somehow had slept for thousands of years and flew to some suburban house and met a weatherman. And so he had to pretend to be the weatherman's dragon puppet on TV. So what you had was a dragon puppet playing a dragon, pretending to be a dragon puppet. And people wonder why it was canceled. Then I got Murphy Brown. And I got Murphy Brown in 1992. And the thing was, this was year five of Murphy Brown. And between the end of year four and the beginning of year five, the United States presidential campaign was going, and the Republican vice president, and he was running again, Dan Quayle, made a comment about how Murphy Brown set a bad example for women by having a baby out of wedlock, because at the end of year four, she had given birth to a baby, and she was not married. And this created, you know, a lot of mockery because, you know, here's a candidate for vice president of the United States. He's criticizing a fictional character, somebody who doesn't exist. And at the same time, you know, around the same time, he also misspelled potato. So the opportunities for mockery were great. And I came on board Murphy Brown, and the first thing that we were doing was we were doing this special one-hour season premiere of Murphy Brown, where we answered Dan Quayle, and we called the episode "You Say Potato, I Say Potato" with an E at the end. It got a lot of media attention. It was an incredible experience, you know, to just all of a sudden, after being on these shows that nobody paid attention to, nobody ever heard of, all of a sudden, you know, there's the media spotlight. And it was a great cast. I mean, Candace, an incredible professional. Everybody, Robert Pasquarelli, unfortunately passed away fairly recently. But it was really my first experience with a show where everybody cared and nobody was a diva. And, you know, the work stood for itself. Unfortunately, that didn't last, and I had to go. I next did a show called Joe's Life. And Joe's Life starred a guy named Peter Onorati. And Peter Onorati, before Joe's Life, had been on a drama, Stephen Bochco's musical experiment called Pop. And Peter Onorati had played a dirty cop who, like, killed people, you know, killed his friends, and, you know, was just a real scumbag. And so, of course, you figure, okay, let's take that character and, you know, let's make him a romantic lead next to Mary Page Keller. So that didn't work, but Joe's Life was created by, and the executive producer was, a guy named Bob Meyer. Bob Meyer had been one of the many executive producers of Roseanne, you know, who she fired serially. And his co-executive producer on that show was a guy named Chuck Lorre. Now, at the same time, the same September that Joe's Life was going on the air, Chuck Lorre had a show going on the air called Grace Under Fire. And Chuck needed help on that show because Brett Booker was crazy. And he asked Bob Meyer, did he know anybody who could come over and help? And Bob knew that our show was getting canceled. He recommended me. So Joe's Life got canceled on a Friday. Monday, I was started on Grace Under Fire. And I did the back nine, the back 11, whatever the rest of that first season was, and yes, she was crazy. At the end of that year, it was very clear Chuck was not going to come back, and neither was I. And I will tell one anecdote about Brett Butler. She got breast implants? She got breast implants at some point, and she was very, very proud of these implants. She actually wanted everybody to feel them, and she actually did it with that 11-year-old kid, and it was a lawsuit. But it's true. But Chuck had the greatest line about Brett's implants. He said, do you know why Brett got implants? I said, no. He said, so when she's in the shower, she doesn't have to look down and see your dick. This is just a great line. Next, I did a show called Dudley, which starred Dudley Moore. A very sweet man. The show did not last very long. Here's the thing. We thought Dudley was drunk most of the time because he really couldn't retain lines. He slurred his speech. And we were there. We didn't shoot this in front of a live audience. We were there very late shooting. What we found out, of course, years later, was that he had a brain tumor. But he was a very, very sweet man, and I enjoyed having worked with him. Next, I did CYBILL, because Chuck was back in the game, and Chuck created CYBILL. And I went over to be his co-executive producer, and if we thought Brett Butler was crazy, hello! What was terrific about that show is Christine Baranski, fantastic, Alicia Witt, you know, just a great supporting cast, but CYBILL could not stand the fact that other people got laughs. And the first 12 episodes, it was a mid-season show, and it really was one of the best experiences in my life, because at the beginning, CYBILL was happy to just be working. You know, she'd been off, she had moonlighting happen, and she'd been out of work for a while, and so she was cooperative, and she was happy to be there, and she'd do anything that we asked. And then we went on hiatus, and during the hiatus, the Emmys came around, she was nominated, Christine was nominated, Christine won, CYBILL didn't. When we came back, it was a whole different kettle of fish, and CYBILL was not happy with anything, and CYBILL ended up firing Chuck and me on Yom Kippur, after in the middle of episode 6 of the year of 24, and that was a sort of good news, bad news situation, because they had to pay us for the whole season. So after that, Chuck went to 20th Century Fox and created Darman and Greg. I went to Columbia and created something nobody's ever heard of called Life and Stuff. This starred a stand-up comic named Rick Reynolds, who'd done a one-man show that got a lot of attention called Only the Truth is Funny. And it was based on that show, kind of. It was also based on his marriage and my marriage, neither of which were in very good shape at that time. And as Rick's wife, they cast Pam Dauber. Pam and Rick had like zero chemistry as far as I could see, but the thinking was, because Rick was a very caustic, sarcastic personality. And the thinking of the network was, well, America loves Pam Dauber from More Dignity, right? And so we put her married to Rick, and if she loves Rick, then America's gonna love Rick. Well, no, as it turned out, America did love Pam Dauber, and they said, why is sweet Pam Dauber married to this asshole? Yeah, so I'm quite proud of the pilot of this, but I quit. Quit was fired, slash. When a train is heading for a cliff, it really doesn't matter if you jump off or you push. After that, I did Bringing Up Jack, which honestly, I thought, I can't remember a thing about it. You can look it up and tell me. Me and the Boys, family comedy. It starred Steve Harvey, who went on to he was a very popular stand-up, and he became a very popular daytime talk show host and game show host and everything else, but the series did not work. Over the Top, wow. This was the show that answered the musical question, will anybody believe Tim Curry is a heterosexual? The answer was no. Did a show called Oh Baby, which was on a cable network. And it was a lot of fun and had a lot of very talented people, but nobody paid attention to it, and it was on the Lifetime Lifetime, after two seasons, noticed that they could get just about as good ratings with reruns of The Golden Girls, so we were canceled. And then came 2.5 Men and Big Bang Theory, and if you want to hear about them, you've got to invite me down again. Q&A time.
Several of your shows. I think growing up, we were talking about this yesterday, but growing up in New Zealand in the 1980s, we very much had a diet of American sitcom, and so
I get
that's actually a question I had, really. Did you know at the time you were working on, or even shows like these ones, that I guess the impact of the success?
No, because I'm just trying to make a living. I'm just trying to avoid starving death. And you know, everything happens. It's such a long. I just sold a pilot to ABC recently, and I was pitching it with a friend. I was told I'd help her because people had helped me. I helped her develop her show and went into the network. And you know, we got some no's, and then ABC said yes, and she's so excited. You know, oh, they said yes. I tried to explain to her, no, Kelly, what's happened is you've been admitted to the parking lot at the bottom of Mount Everest. Okay? There are so many steps that you have to go through, and what you're concentrating on is getting through the next step. And when you're in production, you're really concentrating on getting the script written and getting the show produced, and it really isn't until you're looking at it in retrospect. Then you think to yourself, you know, oh my God, you know, this has had an impact. When I started, you know, after about 3 years or 2.5 Men, and I started traveling, and I noticed that any place I went around the world, people would come up to me and tell me how much they loved the show. That's when I started to get an inkling that it was having an impact. But within our own little world, then, you know, you go back and we're just trying to get to the end of the season. We're just trying to get through the Charlie stuff and, you know, everything.
Has there ever been a moment with a story, you know, when someone's come up to you and said the show made a difference for this reason or that reason?
Yeah. Well, yeah, people have talked about, you know, my mom was sick or my mom was dying and, you know, she got laughs out of this. And, you know, it's very nice to know. I mean, I know that in my life, you know, certain shows had a huge impact on me.
Which ones?
The Dick Van Dyke Show, probably more than anything. Dick Van Dyke Show, in my opinion, is the perfect sitcom. I mean, the perfect sitcom. Perfect casting, perfect writing, perfect everything. It made me want to be Rob Petrie. It made me want to sleep with Laura Petrie. It, you know, it just crystallized in my mind, you know, that's what I want to do. And I think the show holds up still today. So, years later, we have Carl Reiner on 2.5 Men, and Carl Reiner created the Dick Van Dyke Show. And of course, I say to him, you know, you have no idea, you know, what an impact that made. And he goes, yeah. Everybody, don't tell me you became a writer because of Rob Petrie. The things that are personal to us, you know, you can talk about them and you can tell people about them, but it doesn't land. This, you know, it doesn't land the way that you experience it. Carl Reiner will never understand how much Dick Van Dyke Show meant to him.
I mean, you've experienced success at a level which most writers couldn't even dream of working on one of the shows that you've been involved with. What's it actually like to have a number one hit television show? What does it feel like?
It's, believe it or not, you work harder on the failures than you do on the successes. The only different, you know, but it's the same job. I mean, it's the same process. It's the same sitting in a room, breaking stories, you know, writing scripts, going to run-throughs, doing the rewriting, you know, going to shoot night. The difference is when you've got a hit, they leave you alone. You know, when you're starting out or when you're struggling, everybody's got an opinion. and that makes it, you know, 10 times harder. So, yeah, the great thing about Two and a Half Men and the Big Bang Theory is, after maybe episode 3 of Two and a Half Men, we never got another note, except for the censor. You know, that was an ongoing thing, but we never got any creative, you know, story notes or character notes or anything like that.
You had a great analogy when we were talking about Los Angeles being akin to...
Oh my God, okay, the thing you need to understand is that the entertainment industry, at least in the United States, runs on four things. It runs on fear, greed, hope, and bullshit. And what I said was that if fear, greed, hope, and bullshit were petroleum products, Los Angeles would be Abu Dhabi. Because everything that happens in the entertainment industry, you can attribute to one of those four things. And in television, it's usually fear. Because everybody is afraid of losing their job. They're gonna lose it eventually, but the fact of the matter is most of the jobs in television at the network level are not necessary. Or at this, you know, at the studio development level, not necessary. But we have a run through and we've got, you know, 5 people from the network and 4 people from the studio are all sitting there, and how do they justify their existence? Mm-hmm. You know? So they've got, if they have the opportunity to give notes, they will give the notes, and whether they make sense or not, it's all people covering their ass.
Are people, now that you're as successful as you are they still honest with you in terms of, you know, the work, or are people brave enough to sort of suggest if you deliver a script that, you know, you're not firing, or you could do better, or...
See, the difference is now I don't give a shit. No, but people, like, it's not like, you know, I'm 61 years old, okay? So regardless of what I've done, I am not particularly a hot commodity because I'm 61 years old. And nobody is saying, yeah, whatever you want to do, Lee. You know, I'm sure Chuck Lorre gets that, but I don't. And the most valuable thing anybody can have is somebody who will tell you the truth. Because it costs nothing to say I love it. You know, it doesn't.
Do you seek that out as a writer when you...
I want honest opinions.
And some writers don't. That's...
Well, most people don't. Because again, the easiest thing to say about something, if somebody asks you to read something, the easiest thing to do is say I love it. It doesn't cost anything. It makes them feel good. And, you know, you go on your way. But it's worthless, you know. I don't want to hear how much you love it. I want to either hear constructive criticism or I want to check, one of the two.
Has there ever been any criticism, or obviously I think your creative height gets stronger as you go through your career, but is there anything that's ever stood out to you as being particularly hurtful or offensive? You know, obviously it's an industry full of reviews and...
critique. Hurtful reviews. Well, I mean, you can read it in, you know, the first year or Two and a Half Men. And there was a review of Life and Stuff, which I guess would have been hurtful to the guy who took over after I quit and was fired, slash. It said the pilot showed some promise. The pilot showed promise, but then came episode 2 and the stench set in. But if I had been, you know, if I had been the guy who took over, I wouldn't have wanted to read that. Critics make their living, you know, by criticizing. And most of the time, there are people that can't do what we're doing. It doesn't mean that they can't have, you know, apt comments and stuff. But the reason critics get read is because they're entertaining to read, you know, so they can trash the thing in the most colorful, funny way possible. Doesn't really include considering other people's feelings, so, yeah.
Has your sense of humor changed over time?
Oh God, yes, I've got far more cynical and dark and you know, just, fuck you.
I was also wondering, I mean, a huge amount of comedy comes from the notion of struggle, and the more successful you get, is it, you know,
yeah,
you can
it comes from pain, it comes from, and it's good. Same thing in music, you know, you're not going to, you know, when you're a kid and you're angsting over love and existential stuff, you're gonna write some great songs. Paul Simon is never gonna write song Silence Again at 70, rich. You know, you don't I'm not anywhere near as close to my adolescent humiliation, rejection, all this stuff that I went through. I still can get in touch with it if I have to, but comedy comes from pain, comedy comes from struggle, and comedy comes from living life. I mean, and the fact of the matter is that if you live in Los Angeles and you're making a couple million dollars a year and you're sending your kids to private school and you don't really have a lot of life experience that other people can relate to.
So what's the greatest risk to a comedy writer once they've, is it burnout, fatigue, just running out of jokes?
Kind of burnout, complacency, settling. I mean, that's one thing, Chuck Lorre is always saying is, let's not settle. And which doesn't mean we don't occasionally, but it's very easy to, especially if you've got a show that's going, if it's successful, do we really want to stay and spend another 15 minutes trying to beat this joke? It's good enough, let's go. It's a temptation.
Do you enjoy working with other writers, or are you more of a solitary?
Oh, I much prefer having other writers, because if I'm by myself, then I go through what I wrote about. I hate writing, so, yeah.
I read somewhere that Tina Fey had said that humor works because it works best when it's clarifying what people already feel. Do you agree with that, or do you have a maxim that you work to about what makes great comedy?
I think anything that I find funny, and you can ask yourself whether this applies to you, if I look at anything that really makes me laugh, and then ask myself, okay, why is that funny? There's always some pain involved in it. I'll give you an example. On the plane down here, Fleur had me watch a whole bunch of New Zealand programming that was on the plane, and I watched the film What We Do in the Shadows. And has anybody seen that?
Yeah.
And it got to the point, there was one scene where I guess the guy was on, one of the vampires was on a date with somebody, and she's sitting there, she's kind of, and the guy starts laying down newspaper. Okay, that made me start to laugh, because I know this chick is going to get her neck blown out. And the next thing, he's sitting there, and he's covered with blood, and he said, I accidentally hit a major artery. That made me laugh. Now, very few things make me laugh out loud. Those things make me laugh out loud, and they are based at the bottom on somebody's pain, somebody's embarrassment, somebody's physical pain, somebody's emotional pain, whatever. Because, and it doesn't contradict what Tina Fey said, because I think we all relate to pain. I think people who don't have any pain in their lives don't much have much of a sense of humor.
No, I mean, I think happiness is kind of like the serpent. Comedy garden, I think it's something you
the
have
serpent
to.
Serpent in the comedy garden.
Yeah, I prefer it if people don't get
it. It's the title of her forthcoming book.
Sometimes writers bring their Achilles heel, sometimes, say from a story table or a brainstorming, that kind of thing, writers bring their worst traits. We share our worst flaws, habits, that kind of thing, to kind of contribute to story.
I don't know about your worst traits, but you want to capitalize on your most embarrassing moments. You want to capitalize on the pain. I will tell you, if you're familiar with the 2.5 Men pilot, there is a scene where John Cryer's character, Alan, is sitting with his wife, the woman who just threw her out, and she's explaining why she wants a divorce. And she says, "When I'm sitting in my car thinking about coming home to you, I start crying." My ex-wife said that to me the day that she told me she didn't want to be married to me anymore. So, I experienced that pain. Then I put it down on paper, and the joke is, my ex-wife doesn't have a piece of 2.5 Men.
Oh, yeah. guess that sort of leads into this question, really. Is there any particular period of your career that, what, in terms of the highs and lows, is there a halcyon period that you remember or a show with particular fondness?
Oh, no, it's all been horrible. there's fun times. Obviously, you know, there are highs when you sell something or when you get a job, that's high. When you get fired, that's a low. When you get nominated for an Emmy, that's a high. When you don't win, that's a low. When you get sold into syndication, that's a high. That keeps being a high, quite frankly. But it's just like any other job. You know, after you've been doing it for 30 years, you know, it's the things that I remember are just like little things. There's one, like, things that happen on the stage, you know, where you make something work just on the spur of the moment. There was one scene in 2.5 Men, I don't remember the episode or anything, but I remember it had been set up that Alan was going to go break up with some woman that he was involved with. And Charlie gives him the advice that if he hears the sound of metal, if he hears the sound of a gun cocking, he should duck, something like that. And the scene as written is Alan basically breaks up with her, and she says something funny, and he says something funny, and he leaves. And all of a sudden, we're shooting this, okay? The audience is there, and it just suddenly occurs to me. I said to the prop master, "Do you get me a Zippo lighter, okay? Get me a Zippo lighter and a pack of cigarettes." And we have the actress, Alan says what he's gonna say, turns around, the actress takes up a cigarette and clicks open the lighter, okay? And we're shooting straight on Alan, and he just looks like that and does a tumble, okay? It was a perfect payoff to what Charlie had said earlier. And we didn't think about it beforehand, it wasn't written, we just did it, we had to do it very quickly because we're just between takes. And they pulled it off flawlessly in one take, got a huge laugh. That, to me, is, you know, one of the biggest satisfactions that I get in the business. Doesn't mean much to you, but...
I mean, there are so many iterations or versions of what the perfect sitcom is. Do you...
No, there's not. It's a big foundation. Next.
What shows do you enjoy on television at the moment that you think people would be surprised by?
People would be surprised by.
Do you watch a lot of comedy, or do you?
No, God no. I enjoy things that I don't know how to do it. You know, I enjoy things like Breaking Bad and Game of Thrones. I could never write it. I have no idea how they wrote it. You know, it surprises me. Most sitcoms, you know, quite frankly, it's like, you know, it's like a magician going to watch David Copperfield. You know, you'd be impressed on how well they do it, but you know how they do it. And that's the case with most sitcoms. I do watch Veep because I think the dialogue is, you know, incredible. And I watched Silicon Valley when that was on. Other than that, I can't think of any sitcoms I watch.
Okay.
You'd be surprised. Yeah, you asked if there was something that people would be surprised. Yeah, I watched Big Brother this summer. Okay.
Here we go. That's what I'm talking about.
I have guilty pleasure.
Okay, before we the room ask you some questions, hypothetical, you're on a love boat, it's sinking, she's going down. Isaac and Julie have organized you a life raft, and you can take three characters from any show you've ever worked on, and why?
Any show I've ever worked on, three characters to be able to, are we going to survive, or is it something?
I can't promise you that. That's why you've got to pick some good ones.
Oh God, well, if we're gonna be on a desert island, I'm sure there's three girls, three girls from 2.5 Men that Charlie slept with, I'd have to go on. You know, if we're not gonna, you know, if it's questionable if we're gonna survive, then I take Grace from Grace Under Fire. I wouldn't take the actress because she is, as you may have heard, nuts. But the character was very resourceful and strong-willed. Who else? Yeah,
true.
Huh?
Oh, baby.
No, nobody from there.
Next Generation?
You know, the characters, the female characters, who's the best female character?
Murphy.
Yeah, the strongest one was Grace from Grace Under Fire, or Murphy from Murphy Brown, but she was crazy. She Bergen, I could be on a... but mostly I'll go for the bit of those for
you have nothing but honest language. Okay, questions?
Hi, with the Big Bang Theory, you were there from the beginning. That show, time has kind of proved it not to be an issue, but in the beginning it was like, are these nerd stereotypes being rolled out again? Were you worried about the term nerd minstrelsy has been used, and that they're kind of old ideas of nerd caricatures? Were you guys ever worried about that being too obvious, and how did you overcome that?
Well, I don't think that was... The thing is, that show came out of Bill Prady's experience. I mean, and Bill Prady is close to one of those guys. And all of us, everybody on the writing staff, has the nerd, that they, the inner nerd that we channel. So I think one of the reasons that the show has been successful is that they may have seemed like stereotypes at first blush, but very quickly we explored the underlying humanity of them. And what I thought, I just thought, honestly, I didn't think the show had legs at the beginning because we were so limited to just Sheldon and Leonard and Penny, basically. And it was only as we succeeded in expanding the ensemble, and we went through a number of different female characters before we hit on, Amy Farrah Fowler and Bernadette, that it really became possible to go years and years and years with the show.
A lot of, I don't know if you've had a chance to turn on New Zealand TV here, but they put the commercials in different places than where you design them in. And a lot of New Zealand TV creators don't write toward the commercial break. I imagine you can, right off the top of your head, can you do a compare and contrast of how the act breaks in 2.5 are versus the act breaks in Big Bang?
No. honestly, when we're writing, we know, we, 2.5 is let's see, it's cold open, commercial, act one, commercial, act two, commercial, tag. Commercial, commercial, commercial. I think Big Bang is structured the same way, but I couldn't swear to it, but the fact of the matter is that we're just writing towards whatever the network timing is. And if we want to, we could put, sometimes we have put, instead of one act break commercial, we've done a 3-act structure, just because it's just a story better. But once it leaves the network, and once it goes into syndication, they cut it up however the hell they want to. And you see commercials in the middle of a line, and you just can't worry about it. That's it, okay. They were testing the audience. If we did that, it's because the first gag didn't work.
Yeah.
And that's crunch time on a multi-camera show. And that is why, you need all stars on your staff. You need the people who can, something could have been funny at the table read, it could have been funny in the room, obviously. When you pitched it was funny, we laughed. Otherwise, it wouldn't have gone in the script. And obviously, people laughed at the table because it wouldn't have made it past there. Obviously, people were laughing at the first run through. Obviously, people were laughing at the second run through. And then you get it in front of a live audience, and and you're in trouble. And you've got to come up with something else.
So, is it
a question
you have already there, or did you come up?
No, usually no. Occasionally, we'll have something as a backup if we're not quite sure how, if we have some doubts. But most of the horrifying things are the times when you've got a joke or a moment that you think is foolproof, and it just goes over the audience's head. And then it's okay, huddle, and pitch, go out and try one, and if that doesn't work, we try it again. There was one, God, one one scene with Charlie Sheen and Terry Hatcher, where Charlie was trying to explain to her, Terry Hatcher was playing Alan's ex-wife's sister, and we established that at Alan's wedding, Charlie had banged the sister in the restroom while Charlie was getting married, and the sister didn't remember Charlie. And there was a line about how Charlie was trying to explain to her how he used the memory of her as, how should I put this, yank bank material. And the network was very nervous about this, and we did like 7 alt jokes in a row, just over and over again. You know, I use you, you know, when I use you as auto, as flight assist when I'm, you know, flying solo. I use you as hamburger helper when, you know, I'm making a stew by myself. I don't remember. We just went over, you know, and just kept doing and doing to find one that both the audience liked and the network would approve. Interesting anecdote, not particularly funny, but.
Who's more of a nightmare, Civil Shepherd, Great Father, or Charlie Chan?
Charlie was not a nightmare. Charlie was, when we started the show, Charlie was married to Denise. He was sober, and he was great, you know, complete professional. As the years went by, Charlie started to get into trouble when we were on hiatus. But when he showed up on set, he was prepared, professional, no problems at all. It really wasn't until the last year that it started getting out of hand. And it wasn't so much that he was a nightmare, it was we were worried that he was going to end up killing either himself or somebody else. And I, for one, did not want to be in the position that, you know, that Lorne Michaels found himself in with Belushi or you know, Chris Farley or, you know, the people who have enabled the stars to continue destructive behavior, you know, just to keep the money coming in. You know, and it's a hell of a lot of money that you're talking about. But Charlie was never a nightmare. Sybil was a nightmare, and Brett was a nightmare. And I have more sympathy for Brett because Brett had had a tough life. Brett was a stand-up comic, and you know, she'd grown up poor, and she'd been in an abusive marriage, you know, and all those things. You could, with stand-up comics, it's very hard to trust anybody because you're used to just being in charge of everything. It's you and a microphone in the audience. All of a sudden, you get a sitcom, you gotta trust a group of writers and a director and lighting guys and, you know, costumers and all that stuff. That's very hard to let go. So I could have some sympathy for Brett. Sybil Shepherd has always been Sybil Shepherd. And whatever her demons are, you know, life, I don't think life gave them to her. She just made so many people miserable. It's hard to forget.
When you were talking before that you write for money, I could hear this audible gasp to come across the room. I think in New Zealand we're quite hesitant to make money off creativity.
You know, you can write some stuff for me, I'll pay you in canned goods.
And a lot of people in this room would have been have done a lot of work to read. I'm just interested in how you approach creativity and money coming together and how you...
Well, I'm kind of an anomaly because it was never my plan to be a writer. You know, it wasn't like I grew up and I want to be a writer. I want to be a writer. No, I hate writing. I really do.
What did you want to be?
A stand-up comic, an actor, a performer. You know, something that isn't that hard work. you know, I did stand-up for free, and you know, which is why I was so broke. I had to take the writing job. You know, when you're doing something that you love and you know that fulfills you, yeah, of course you're willing to do it for free. When you're doing something that you know causes you great pain and emotional suffering, not so much. and that's just me. I'm not saying you know that's the reason to do it. The things I'm doing now, since I've left the shows, I'm now doing because I want to do them. not for the money. You know, I wrote this presentation is a few years old while I was still working on both shows. But I don't have to do things for the money now. I can choose to do the things I want to do, which is a very lucky place to be in, and it's a much happier place to be in.
Is it just the sitcom genre where the writers that you are on set? So the writers in New Zealand, do you get to be on set?
Well, it depends. Okay, a multi-camera show. Okay, a show where we're filming in front of a live audience. We've got four cameras. We got audiences sitting in bleachers. Okay, we're on set because we have to be, because when something goes wrong, you know, you need to fix it. On a single camera show, just like on a movie, the writers go home and the director stays late. You know, and the actors stay late. And multi-camera shows, the actors go home early, the writers stay late. And in films, you know, the director is God. On a TV show, especially a multi-camera show, the director is basically a hired hand. He's just there to do the camera blocking and make sure they're all pointing in the right places. And it's the executive producers who are writers, who are in charge creatively of the whole show. So yes, we are on set. In films, no, writers have complained for years that the directors don't want them around.
Got time for one more question.
From season to season, how locked in your storyline before you start shooting? And have you ever had to change direction halfway through?
That's a two-part question. Is he allowed two parts? Our season is basically in August. The writers will come together and we'll start talking stories and we'll talk, right? In June. We'll get together and we'll start talking and write and we're writing scripts, and the goal is to have 6 or 7 scripts ready by the middle of August, which is where we start shooting. And then we start shooting in sets of 2 and 3. You know, we shoot 2 episodes, then down a week, 3 episodes, down a week. And we go through that through the year, maybe a couple of weeks off for Christmas, and we end the season in early April. And then we collapse and go to Hawaii. Or if you're Charlie Sheen, you know, you go and you marry somebody and hold a knife to their throat or whatever. And we come back and you know, do the whole thing again. That's the typical production year. You have to occasionally change your plans when, like, your leading actor goes off the rails and you have to fire him. Or something like that. In smaller examples are, you've got a guest star scheduled, a guest star falls out for some reason, they get sick, they can't make it, whatever, and you've got to scramble, you've got to change things. But we don't, you know, for the most part, we don't think of a whole season ahead. You know, we're thinking, you know, at most, we're thinking an arc of maybe 2 or 3 episodes. And, you know, hopefully by the time we get to that end of that arc, we'll have thought of something else to move forward.
Keep talking.
I notice women do not ask questions. They're just women.
They're very submissive.
Can I get phone numbers?
Thank you, everybody, for coming. And thank you so much to Film New Zealand.
Thank you. This was a lot of fun.